Yeah, I don't have the Argus on,
I'm on a different computer just to
put
the Argus in.
Gentlemen and.
Yes, ma'am.
The lady.
Lady.
Hey, gentlemen.
You're the writer.
All right, good morning. Here's our agenda for the day. Our guest lecturer will be arriving at 9 o'clock. So that gives us an opportunity to start with our class. Our design folks will come in and then we'll go back to the rest of our class. There will also be an opportunity for you to regroup in your groups as well. So we're at 90% this morning, which is pretty good. So I'm going to start off and ask you for the news of the week. I also sent you an email which will incorporate into our discussion on underwriting the deal and structuring the deal, because I think the article is actually quite germane to our discussion. So I'd like to hear your news of the week. There's news.
Point seven.
Airports in Pompano, DCRA. That's all I got.
All right, then we'll just take you out of the discussion. This morning we'll start with Ben.
There's been an undisclosed settlement in the United passenger suit.
What do you think the settlement is?
7 figures at least.
At least, I think it's 8.
I think it's 3.
And a promise not to bring
like
giant rabbits on the flights.
Huh?
And a promise not to bring a giant rabbit on United Airlines.
I think it's probably going to be.
I thought I got free flights for life.
And buddy's always on standby.
So what do you think the benefit is of an undisclosed settlement?
It just puts the issue. It stops the bleeding, puts the issue not behind you, but it just stops the media publicity of lawyers going back and forth. And
so did anybody?
Yeah, it comes with an NDA. So.
Did anybody actually see the? I won't call it an apology, but their list of their revised corporate statement as to how they are actually dealing with the issue.
No.
There was a huge advertisement. It was actually in the New York Times in the print edition, which said what they are now going to do, and they actually released a statement saying that they now will offer up to $10,000 for what they call voluntary reboarding. I can't figure out why it's ever voluntary, because if they kick you off, it's never voluntary. They will never forcibly remove you and all those other sorts of things. Anytime baggage is misplaced, $1,500 automatically.
Crazy. That is crazy, though.
That's pretty awesome.
No, I think
that will not last.
I think $10,000 to offer somebody to give up their seat.
Up to. In other words, what they're doing is that they're attempting to, and I think it's too late, change corporate culture. In other words, giving the latitude for people in the front gate area to make the, at least have the ability to make decisions.
It won't get to 10,000 because
it will be always.
Yeah, I mean, if you tell me I'll give you $2,000, I'm out and I'll go have a nice
bump
meal
for 2 hours.
Get wasted.
Yeah, but you know,
get into the lounge.
There's gonna be those people because they're gonna have a guideline based on the flight duration. I'm sure they'll have some kind of guideline based on the structure. And you know, there's gonna be somebody in there straight from the hood on their first flight, and they're like, no, I want the 10, it's gonna turn into another nightmare. So,
maybe, maybe not. Actually, I will tell you that it could be 10,000, it won't change me if I have a meeting that's critical for you.
Well, yeah, I mean, if,
that's
yeah,
right.
Of course.
So, okay, so that's Ben's
but
biggest
it would
reason.
Never get there because people need $10,000.
Depends who's on what flight, that's for sure. All right, any other news beyond United?
What I'm saying is there will be other people on your flight that will need that. Just if you,
of course,
statistically, you know, unless you're flying Emirates Air and, you know.
Your OGs.
That's correct. All right, so any other news beyond our air traveling public here?
Yes, 0.7% growth.
Okay.
Which was projected to be.
Right, so we're going to talk about that. And is that meaningful?
Sure.
Right, so now the president owns it, right?
Yeah.
I mean, how can he really own it 100 days into office?
Because it's the first quarter.
Yeah.
And 90 days is the first quarter.
No, I know, but how can you implement
changes day one? Because he tried to own the last quarter.
To show after one quarter, but that's fine.
And I want to discuss that, because you're right. And can any president, can any politician, can any government really manage, run, and own that kind of thing? So I think there's an interesting. Well, after any number of days, and you're right, so there's a real question there as to whether or not it's as dire as it sounds or not. So I want to bring up some statistics based upon that. All right, what else in the economic
North
or real
Korea,
estate news?
Well, Trump wants South Korea now to help pay the missile system in North Korea.
Oh, just like Mexico's going to pay for the wall?
And North Korea had a failed attempt again yesterday.
They did. So is it, and that's why I want to, when we talk about structuring deals, the article that I sent you, and we'll read it in a few minutes, about whether negotiations, because this really is very focused on real estate, whether how you negotiate makes a big difference.
When was that article sent out to the New York Times? Was that like yesterday or a few days ago, sometime this week?
It was the beginning of the semester. When he sent out the course pack.
The one that I just sent out to you 10 minutes ago was in yesterday's New York Times about, and the upshot, and we'll talk about that, about how one deals with
the
industry.
Yeah, so talking about Trump knowing new deals, Trump wanted to, the U.S. to exit out of NAFTA, which caused a big upheaval.
So this goes back to how you present your case and whether it makes sense for anybody to play good cop, bad cop, and we'll get to that. All right, so is there NAFTA, is there not? So I think we'll hold off anything on Mr. Trump for just a minute, because he seems to be the issue. So let's go back to Jason, and then we can go back to
you. I have some local news.
Local, that's great.
Palm Beach County, the last large agricultural tract that they've been trying to make agricultural, or it is agricultural reserve, a developer has purchased it, and they're planning to rezone and actually got approval.
Where is it located? That's
Boynton. Yeah, it's way west on Boynton.
Way
Boynton
far west.
Is that off the Turnpike?
I saw it in the real deal, and I thought of you because you like to create value and sell it.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
well,
I figured you were following that.
Well, so I am following it. And so what's interesting is that, and actually just yesterday, Arden just had its grand opening, which is a Ryan development, and it's on Southern Boulevard. It's 10 miles west of the Turnpike, and so in our world of South Florida,
that's way too far.
10 miles is
way too far.
Is way too far. And but if you and you
see
the signs,
that far?
But if you see the signs, it's fascinating. The signs and if you know Casey McDonald of the O'Donnell Group, actually Casey O'Donnell. She's done the marketing and advertising, and it's brilliant. And it has a huge sign that says Arden. By the way, the name Arden, does it sound familiar? Arden. What does the name Arden evoke? What is it evocative of? A-R-D-E-N.
Like a dragon?
Arden?
Arden.
Pardon? Like
a dragon? Darden. Dragon. I love that.
So and I'll put it up. Because branding and marketing is really important. And so sometimes, so for example, I live on a street called Oxford Court. And so there the idea is, and every street in my development is Oxford.
Very regal.
It's British. You know, yeah.
Hampton
K, Piccadilly, Darlington. So there it has that particular.
Do you wear tunics in the weekend? On the weekend? Do you wear tunics?
So but Arden actually is a completely made-up name, but it's trying to evoke some sort of pastoral meme. And here this is just an old agricultural field, and they've created this mile-long lake. But of course, if you zoom in on Google, and we'll do that, it is what it is. Yes. So
I mean, because you're basically out in the Everglades, so you got to find a place to put the water, right?
As far as I'm concerned, it might as well just be 20 miles out. So, which is really interesting.
But
it's just beyond Wellington.
But it's, you know, it's the last large agricultural.
There are these
parcels.
Huge
in South
agricultural.
Did it hit like Everglades National Park yet, or no? It's not that
far. No, not at all. But if you can buy
reserve.
A home, if you can buy a home.
How many acres is it?
I don't know exactly. But if you buy a home from the 300s as opposed to the...
Why would you pay $300,000 out there? It's just so far.
The materials have fresh gator tail.
So that, all right, so...
Brand new product.
You can make your money catch the pythons in the airport.
There you go. Any other news? We'll get to it. Any other news? Daniel, back to Daniel, then you go.
Yeah, there's news about a new legislation for changing the rules. see.
Yeah.
Does anyone help me change how the loans are structured for that? Instead of where the borrowers have to put down their equity based on the cash invested on the property, they now have to provide cap. They now put the equity based on the projects.
All right, while you're thinking
value.
About that, so this is no new change that I know of, because it's just a matter of loan to value changes. So these are just lender requirements. There's no actual regulatory changes that I know of. Okay, Luis.
Okay, this is very, very small. It's not in the news yet, but...
What did you buy?
From the camera. No. This week I've been helping to organize the first paddle championship in the U.S. Paddle is a European sport similar to tennis and squash.
The badminton?
What is it?
It's like
pickleball.
It's like a combination between tennis and squash. Small rackets, smaller courts. So this week I've been helping a developer to organize this event in between 7th and 8th Street on Ocean Drive.
Alright.
And it's been a chaos, but it's working really well. And maybe you guys will see it next week on the news.
All right, and that will help the real estate how?
Well, it's going to actually help the real estate, because this developer saw an opportunity in cities like Weston that don't use tennis courts anymore. So he's trying to buy those courts and, I guess, build a paddle courts with, you know, glasses and new nets so he can... You know, bring people to play.
Okay. All right, so the lesson there may be that just as where malls need to be experiential or transformative, amenities have to also change and continue to be updated to attract
construction
the target
is down,
market.
Construction is down in South Florida 18% year over year.
And you're talking about residential, right? Let's see what he's looking at.
What are you looking at?
No, he went on to the real deal, and his construction starts are down, but he's not talking about what. So it's an income.
Do we have a point of reference to know? All
right.
I think it's off. Commercial construction.
Well, so you got to look at it before you come into class before you make a statement like that.
An article.
I was trying to pull a Ben.
The Wall Street Journal.
Yes.
A Ben.
Oh. Right. I mean, I want you to read before you get to class, folks.
There was an article in the Wall Street Journal that
I already read it. You remember
there's concerns about an overheating housing market, right? Like strong demand, strong supply, and I guess there's concerns that could be an issue.
It's always an issue. The key is, once again, that means we're aware and where and how and when on the real estate cycle. Vitaly, you're back.
Good morning. I have very exciting local news. We are buying a piece of land in Wood and we'll open the hotel.
Okay.
And it has no impact on real estate.
Oh, it has none. Oh, okay, fine. You and I would talk about
that. Is it an hourly hotel or?
About that. Okay. All right, so actually, I thought what was really interesting, because now we'll go back to Mr. Trump, because this tax plan, which is one sheet of paper and it is no plan, just hit because, actually, the most interesting part about this is.
15%?
Well, I like it too, if it made sense. And so the challenge here is that if you have disparate rates between personal and corporate rates, then you can really upset the whole system. And so if you have a plan that says, oh, if my personal rates are at 35 or 39%, but you allow anybody to structure themselves personally and take advantage of corporate rates at 15%, so everybody can incorporate as an LLC, and then you shift your income. Now, for most people who don't earn much, it won't make a difference, but let's say you are Mr. Trump. But let's
anybody.
Say,
I mean,
well,
unless you're like in the low, I mean, if you're making maybe like a median, you're already paying over 15% on that portion of the income.
Look, I have an S-corp, and I have an LLC. I can just simply say, let's make a very simple example. And let's say you earn $100,000, and you simply say, all right, I'll say $10,000 of it is personal income, the rest is corporate income, And so the corporate income ends up getting shifted and is serviced as 15%, and that shifts the entire system.
Yeah, but he offset that because of the amount of the standard deduction. So the standard deduction, you have to make a shitload of money.
Well, then it really affects people who are earning about $1 million or more. I did a calculation. So, but there's a real challenge here as to whether or not one can make this work when you have this huge.
But I think he's talking about also potentially getting rid of the interest deduction as part of that raising of these.
Yeah, well, that's right. And so they want to save just.
So you might go from 12.6 now to 30,000, but a lot of people bank on the interest deduction, which you're probably getting the benefit by going with the higher standard, but still. I mean, I like the
mortgage and charity. Those are the only two deductions they want to save. So there's a real disconnect, I think, on the two of these. There's another article which showed up.
Me too.
Because it'll privatize a lot of government things, which is good, because then you add efficiencies of its private sector. But let's say it's something good about Trump. We're not going to do that in this class.
Uh-huh. Yes, I'm sure.
It's coming.
Remember we tried to have the conversation before it was here?
Yes.
I offered that constructive criticism.
Did all of you see this particular article?
No.
Is that a face?
The New York Times.
Yeah, that's a but it could be a face reading a book.
Is that about the article about China?
Well, it wasn't on China. Let's see if I can get the start.
Feng Shui is Japanese, right?
Or is it Chinese?
It's Asian.
I think it's Chinese.
Chinese. I'm pretty sure it's Chinese.
Well, that relates to real estate.
It's Chinese.
So I can't get it to start. Oh gosh, always the ad first.
Ever since I got that.
I just thought it was skip ad in 13 or 14. Beats.
Oh yeah, well, now that you mentioned Bill Gates, big news, Bezos might actually surpass Bill Gates as the world's richest guy.
So, yes, it's interesting.
Good for Amazon.
I actually just had an issue with Amazon saying they didn't receive items that were returned. And I went to my cart, it shows they were returned, so I called them. They answered within 2 minutes and refunded the money within a few hours again because they had charged again.
This guy's got a lot of money for a company that doesn't like work off of big markets, right?
It's going to be data, dude. Think about Alexa in every home. They're collecting personal data. They're going to know when you want to crack. They're going to know, you know, who you want to have an affair with. They're going to know everything.
They're going to know exactly what you look like every morning.
So for some reason, that's not working.
Yeah. You get a message saying, look, I should come on. Yeah,
so forget that. All right, sorry. I don't know why that's not working. And so I'm going to go back. So we'll forget that. Okay. So
then do some pull-ups. Will know more about you than you know about yourself. And didn't they say a couple years ago they are going to cater products to be shipped to you without you even asking for it, and then if you don't like it, you can send it back?
If you say so.
All right.
So here the issue was, yes, GDP has only gone up 0.7%. What was really interesting in the New York Times article is that actually in the first quarter of almost every year, GDP actually has only gone up very low. So can any president or any administration really change that? Well, Howard, hello, how are you?
Hello.
Hey.
He's early.
Well, yeah, I can just sit here and listen to you.
So I was going to go through the news of the week and complete that first before we started with our guest lecturer. And I'm just taking another 10 or 15 minutes or so. And then we'll get to our guest lecture, and then we'll go back to our. So Howard Steinberg is going to be a very interesting lecture, I guess. So
in a way, yes.
That's right. Yeah, we still are being recorded, aren't we? Great, excellent. So what was interesting about the article in the news of the week is that even the New York Times says that, of course, can any administration manage or change what's going on despite the target where President Trump says that he'd like Congress to achieve 5% growth. So the first quarter, now he owns it, yes, it's 0.7%. But what's really interesting, of course, is that even if you look at consumer confidence, which is way up, and plans for purchasing appliances and cars are actually still at the same level for most other economic expansions. And so effectively, it appears as though the economy may still be on track for that 2 to 2.5% growth rate. Not 5%, not 4%, not 3%, but effectively at 2%. So there's still a lot of heavy lifting that has to be done. So I don't think the numbers are going to change. These are the stark charts and stats that we've seen before. But here, and this seems to prove it, durable goods orders, which once again is what kind of indicator?
Leading.
Leading, that's right. Just seems to prove that, and that hasn't changed in the last couple of quarters. So I just want everybody to notice that. What one thing is that jobless claims are up, so that's a negative leading indicator. So that's a little bit of a concern. One thing that also is interesting is that new home sales were up. So that's a positive, even in light of the mortgage rates still going up. And the core logic case chiller index is up. So I don't have that much news of the week, but I just want to be alert to it. One thing that I thought was interesting, there's a new house hunting app in Hong Kong that sees dead people. I thought that was really interesting. You didn't notice that one?
No.
It's a house hunting app that you can download now.
Well, you know, you just kind of aim your phone.
Yeah, and it like takes stuff.
That's right, and it just says, oh, and it points to where somebody has died, and it says which apartment that is, and you know,
weird.
Well, in China, just like we're superstitious with the 13th floor, people in various other cultures are superstitious on the number 4, the number 8, and whether somebody has died suspiciously on a certain level. So here in this particular residence, two Indonesian women were found in the apartment of a British expat on the 31st floor, and so that kind of will slow the sales of that particular unit. So you know there are ways to...
It's all pretty weird there. Two women and British bankers.
Once again, this is a way to either enhance or affect the sales of your real estate. And so I'm sure there are apps here in the United States. You know, Zillow is one way to look at that. And so I thought I'd mention that. And the other news of the week, because I've mentioned it and I thought I'd tell you about it, is that finally I had to put down my dog, George, yesterday. So this is back in, 13 years ago. This is George and his brother Jonah, who passed away last year. But when George was at his prime, he was like the 80-pound hunting dog, if you will. He was quite the guy.
How long did he live?
Huh?
How long did he live?
He lived almost 15 years. And so this is a picture of me with him yesterday. Actually, one of the neighbors took that picture. And this is him just actually 2 days ago before decided yesterday that it was best for him to be comfortable and go to the eternal rest, if you will. So he didn't quite make it, you know, the fourth time round. He decided it was time for him to just go down. All right, so now it's time for Howard. Let's switch and see if we can get to a good presentation here. I thought you'd like to see the images. He was a great dog, and it's real sad, but he's in a better place. All right. Howard, you are up now, and so we're real pleased. I'm pleased to have Howard Steinholz. He has a company called The Urban Group, and I'm going to let him take the stage and tell you all about what he does. It's another kind of real estate activity and efforts here, and this is going to give me the opportunity to go back and maybe eat a little bit of breakfast as well. So Howard, you are front and center. I'm going to go off to the side now with the buttons.
I don't know if I want to start after that.
Well,
George is a good guy,
and
we'll find another companion at that point.
Okay, Mark, thank you for inviting me back again.
Sure.
I didn't know you were going to do that. But I'm happy. Mark, okay, my name's Howard Steinholz. My company is called The Urban Group. We are a public sector real estate company. We work it mostly with agencies, government agencies, agencies that also have public sector developments, and those are composites of money that private money and public money. We currently, for your information, we're currently working at the Miami International Airport at the Miami Intermodal Center. Have you ever, you know that? Intermodal Center is to the east of Lejeune, and it has the area has the rental cars.
Oh yeah.
Has Tri-Rail, Amtrak coming in, Greyhound if you guys use it, and the Miami-Dade Transit. So we manage that property. We don't manage it fully. We work for the Florida Department of Transportation. So we are a consultant, a real estate consultant, to FDOT. And we currently work in District 6, which is Miami, and District 4, which is in Fort Lauderdale. And we've worked for District 1, which is in Bartow. We've worked in District 7 in Tampa. So we're a public consultant. We qualify by providing real estate people who work in acquisition of land. We buy out the roads so they get widening. We also have to provide what's called relocation for displaced businesses and residents when we go in and take their home. And when I say we take it, it's condemnation. We buy it out based on a fair market value. So with that said, we are also appraisers. While we don't appraise necessarily what we buy for the state, we do get the values through. Currently, we're working for the city of Fort Lauderdale, the Transportation and Mobility Department. And anybody live in Fort Lauderdale here? Okay, you, Broward Boulevard and Southeast 15th Street. We are doing what's called a corner clip. And that's one of the, so we're buying out a portion of it. But it isn't money, we're using money, but we are buying that clip as an easement. So we buy the easement. It's about 20 feet wide, and it allows for the property owner to build what the project they want. So we're buying that, and that's another thing we do. So we have, I have 21 people in our company, and they all, except for even administrative people, they all have real estate licenses. And so we qualify because we have a real estate license. We qualify because we have experience with certain elements in the acquisition process. So we've been in business for 31 years, the right-of-way business has been very good to people in our business, because there's been a lot of transportation work and there's been a lot of acquisition for roadway. We have in that acquisition process or our business process, I'm putting here this is the Intermodal Center, okay, and this is the facility. Here is our office. This building is this is where the rental is, and this is the acquisition area that we purchased, this whole thing. Behind here, there's another area that's being built. Here, I don't know if you guys, this is the facility into the rental center. That's our work with FDOT in Miami. But our work also involves development with housing and community development. So one of the things we do is help in the development of housing. This is an apartment building that we did in Liberty City. This is a conglomerate of, this is called Hampton Village. Landmark Development is a corporation. They received federal dollars through HUD. This is a nonprofit sponsor that was part of it. And this is another, this is the Housing Finance of Miami that gave them money. They borrowed money from Citibank, and they used, at this time, the Miami-Dade Neighborhood Stabilization Program. And that was, Obama did that during the crisis of real estate. And so they had $11 million into that project. We also worked with the City of Lake Worth, the Community Redevelopment Agency, when we had that was a $23 million project. We bought out, as their consultant, 150 homes. They were returned back to the community as in restricted requirements of income. So they were all they're all single family homes. So we built a couple of condominiums as well. So, if you will, let me go through this thing. So this is our work. This is transportation, like, again, and this is our housing and community development part. This is the homes we built in Lake Worth. This is one we bought the homes, renovated it with a developer, and this is one of the projects we did in the same Lake Worth that was built by the Community Redevelopment Agency, and it was an artist colony. Artists can work and live in this apartment complex. Also, the rents are in these $1,200. They're two bedroom, two bath, with a studio for working. Next slide, please. Okay. So here's our company profile. We work with nonprofits. We work with public developers. So, anybody here is a developer, you might look to us to help buy out the property and relocate residents that have to be cleared out. This real estate business of our business platform is a willing seller and eminent domain. We work under the Federal Uniform Relocation Act. And that requires that we find a replacement home for residents, tenants, owners, and for businesses. So one of the local areas we just finished is State Road 7. State Road 7 from County Line to past the Hard Rock. So that area, we bought out properties except for the Seminole properties. They did it themselves. Interesting story about that acquisition. The Seminoles wanted to handle the acquisition by themselves. However, they wanted to do it their way, not the state FDOT way. So I went to negotiate with the Seminoles, and they were great people. They were really nice. The attorney asked me, if you want, we would allow you to do your work, that work. However, we want to have you put a turnpike exchange on Sterling Road, which is close to the hotel. And I said, oh, well, I'll bring it up to the powers that be. And in this case, we worked for the Florida Turnpike Enterprise. That's also an FDOT element. And they're strictly dealing with the turnpike. So I went to their offices in Ocoee and spoke to the director, and I said, this is what they want. And he said, well, let me go back and I'll figure what we can do. They came back to me and said, it's going to cost $80 million to put the exchange in. So I went back to them and I said, we can't do it. And they just did the road themselves. If you've ever seen that road, it looks the same from Orange Drive to the border of Miami-Dade, because they followed the regulations, actually. And they're still building, by the way. So that's the Uniform Act had us on that street. We had 108 parcels to purchase. About half of those were businesses. So we had to find a replacement for the business. You know, there were a couple of convenience stores. We found them all the places to move to. There was a couple of gas stations we had to take out as well. We had to follow the Uniform Act, and that involved fair market payments. It involved finding a comparable a building, and those are kind of hard. It took us 3 years to get through this project. Much of the land was taken for drainage, by the way, and not on State Route 7. West Park was created because of some of the stuff that we did. We also, as I mentioned, we do appraisals. We do appraisals and review appraisals. We do mostly appraisals for government agencies. We don't, because we stay within the government milieu, so that we don't have a conflict with what we do. Our appraisal work is, right now we've got work for Miami-Dade County, we've got work in Broward County, that cliff was, so we handle all of that as strictly for the agency or the government entity or the public-private developer. Which I'm pointing at is that the developers get money mostly from HUD, truthfully, and then most of it is housing. There's you know of Related Housing? You guys are familiar with them? They're a developer that uses lots of money that's federal. They also use tax credit money, and that's another means of developers getting money to build affordable housing. Much of the affordable housing that gets done now requires there be transportation close to it. So that first development I said to you with Landmark, they built that close to an elevated train for Miami-Dade County.
When you said Related, is that the Related group, the same people?
Yeah.
In fact, let's go back a couple of slides, because I want to frame what Howard is talking about. But the reason why I invited Howard is that everybody thinks of development as being a private sector endeavor. And what Howard does, and I'm going to reel this back a little bit, is that he really is the interstice or the interface between the public and the private sector. And what's unique is there's a huge amount of work, and people don't realize, that the public sector engages in. And Howard really fills that role. The public sector, the counties, the state, and the local city or village governments don't have the expertise, nor should they really be engaged in it unless they have their own redevelopment authorities who don't really know what to do, in being in the real estate business. And so they hire companies, as if he has competition, but he has some, right?
No, there's competition.
Companies like Howard's Urban Group to be their consultant or their agency to go out and be, in effect, their developer, their acquirer of properties, or their agent to undertake their projects. So, from the way I look at it, so clearly, big project, obviously, for the intermodal terminal at Miami. And if any of you have been, like I've been, to the rental terminal and the intermodal terminal, they assembled all of that land adjacent to there to put that together for the airport. And they did that in a way that was hopefully in a market environment that was advantageous to the county and didn't lift up the prices. And where it didn't, then they used eminent domain. And they did that also in other ways, so that clearly, so when in Lake Worth they wanted to redevelop housing, they did it so that they could enhance the community. When they did it for housing community development in Broward, so they could encourage certain social and other goals for artist community, they did it where the private sector would not step in and where there was no incentive to do it. And so this is a large body of work that others don't or fear to go. Now, by the way, companies like Related Group, you know, George Perez and others, they built their empire. What you don't know, Steve Ross up in New York and George Perez actually got into the business of affordable housing using tax credits, and that's how they created huge cash flows, which allowed them to go into the private sector, where they, in fact, built their empire on condominium and these huge private sector developments. And they actually did a lot of the public sector work that Howard also now does, but only for the public sector agencies. And so I think there's an interesting realm there that people don't realize that people can get engaged in. And whether it's doing it just for the public sector agencies or managing the gulf between the two, that's a realm of work that a lot of you are not aware of. And in fact, Howard has hired individuals from the program here, some of your colleagues, in fact, before in last year's classes, worked for him on that basis. Go ahead, yes.
So just to be clear, so for example, the Related Group, when they're doing that public development, they're not your competition. They're using you. They're teaming up with you in order to, or are you competing with them? I'm not clear on that.
Yeah, no, we facilitate with them. We're hired by the developer to work in those parts that require. When there's federal money, for instance, that we handle that. So
here, for example, here's a list of Howard's clients that leads into this particular slide.
Yeah. Let me see this slide. Let me point myself to something here.
Daniel, put that.
Actually, if you could put it down, it'd be better.
Put it down. Easier for him to read. Sorry about that.
Okay, so what Mark is saying is, what do? We're a facilitator.
Okay.
All right, so let's look at a government agency, the Environmental Protection Agency. So the Environmental Protection Agency has a real estate division. They have people who have an appraisal division, but they don't go out and buy the properties. They ask an agency or a company like the Urban Group, and there's other ones, by the way. There's actually an affiliation called the International Right-of-Way Association that we belong to, and it's a group of it's nationwide, and so it's not just the Urban Group. It's probably about 20 or 20 so companies in the state of Florida that work like we do. Some of them are engineering firms where they have a right-of-way division.
Well, let me get back to it. Let me give you some areas of this. This is the Dominion Group. Is a company out of Minneapolis, and I'm an urban planner. I went to Florida State University, and I got my graduate degree at FAU in urban planning. I was working for the city of Hialeah. This is about 20 some odd years, more than that, 30 years ago. These guys came to me, and I was working on the Housing and Community Development Division, and they asked me if I would help them on a housing, on a HODAG grant, which is a HUD grant, and to build market housing that mixes public housing. And so this group, we put together a 245 rental units in Hialeah, and these 62 units were public. They were townhouses. People received Section 8 housing, and you couldn't tell the difference between the market and the public housing. That was a great development that I was part of. After that, I got hired by an architectural firm who did public sector architecture and worked for them, and that's how we got the Urban Group. We started to build public housing. So
did you assemble the property for the Dominion Group? What was your actual role for them at that
time? We assembled the land.
All right.
That was in Hialeah.
Where in Hialeah? You remember? Where in Hialeah?
It was east of it was 8th Avenue or 6th or 7th Avenue, I can't remember. It was close to the City Hall.
Okay. Oh yeah, I know where it is.
We did another project in West Palm Beach with Dominion. This landmark thing is really, that's the latest stuff, and they were great. They built 100 units and 2 and 3 bedroom, 2 bath units. You had to be income qualified to get those units. I currently am working with a firm called, they fired us. This is Atlantic Pacific Communities, and we're working on a project in Coral Springs, where the Archdiocese of Miami has several senior housing projects, and they hired Atlantic Pacific to renovate the project. It's 419 units in Coral Springs. It's called St. Andrew's Towers. Two separate buildings. We were hired by Atlantic Pacific to relocate the residents while they're living there. And the way we're doing this is that these are all senior citizens. Many of them are very, you got to help them, and we're sort of like a social worker as well. But they hired us to relocate the residents, and the way we're doing that is that the vacant units that are ready to go to be renovated, we put them in temporarily for 60 days, and when the new unit is done, we relocate them, we move them back into the unit. So we hire, we handle the move, we don't do the construction, and we hire a moving company to move the residents. And we photograph every new unit and every old unit to make sure that no one feels like somebody stole their TV or their favorite picture or something like that. But that's a that's the kind of work that you can do in this project. Yes.
What kind of work did you do for the South Palm Beach County Jewish Federation?
We did the funding application for them, and managed the construction of their. They have two. There's two buildings there.
Are you familiar with them? Headquarters?
Yeah. Yeah. The two buildings, and so we did the funding reservation, and we were qualified by HUD. We had to have a real estate license to do this work.
I didn't know if there was a residential component to that.
Yeah, it's all of these they call them they call them the new name is HUD. Let me get this right. They changed this thing. They're HUD facilities now, sponsored by an agency like the Jewish Federation or like the Archdiocese, or we work with the. An agency that is like public housing, we'll do the same thing. So, but it's all a matter of getting the money, working with money, following the regulations. All of that, everything that is done is under that Uniform Act.
And by the way, may I ask, with the release, the plan, budget, and the funding for HUD, how does that impact that program going forward? Do you have any concept as to whether or not that puts the kibosh on the kinds of activities that you're doing?
There hasn't been any. Not a lot of money goes to these projects now.
So the funding for most of these activities generally tends to be local, then, as opposed to coming out of the federal, even though it's a federally sponsored program, the funding tends to be a local funding apparatus.
It's actually competitive. In Florida, there'll be a appropriation of money for doing work, and there's agencies that we would help to get the project. And now the money becomes better used by joining private sector into it, because the private sector gets they have their money, they get their funding, they have money, and it works together. And I see a lot more of that at this point. I see that going.
So you mentioned. Let me just ask this question. So you mentioned. So you're working for these not-for-profit organizations. You have to have a real estate license, for example, when you either acquire or help build it. So are you earning a fee on a commission basis, or are you earning a set fee based on a project basis, for example, when you work for these companies?
We negotiate our fees. We don't take any commissions.
Mm-hmm.
So, like I would tell you, there's a slide in here where I talk about compensation.
Oh, okay.
So, but why don't we go back to that? Because it's a good question.
Which slide?
You're going to have to hit it back from this book, close to the back.
Let me just see if I can find that.
Okay. So, how do I make money? How do we make money in our work? Great. So, we will follow a request for qualifications. That would be an agency would use us and consider the qualifications that we have on a project. That's an RFQ. We also have a letter of interest, and this is of interest to me. A letter of interest is what we give to the Florida Department of Transportation. We send a letter, a two-page letter to them, and they qualify us as to whether they're interested in our company to do work in right away. They usually do there's three firms that are selected. We get an interview, and then we negotiate the dollars. So how we negotiate with FDOT is that
There's a list of types of properties that we have to require. Vacant land, residentially improved, commercially improved, industrially improved, residential improved, as I said. Each one of those get a different cost factor. It's a unit rate. So on a vacant land, we may charge $5,000 to buy land. And that doesn't, and that $5,000 or $10,000, whatever it is, doesn't matter how big that land is. You know, it's five, it could be 5 acres, it could be 1 acre, it's still five, it's still gonna be the same dollar amount.
So you become a disinterested facilitator and third party. So if you sell it for $1 million or $10 million,
that's right,
it's irrelevant.
Yeah. We had at the Fort Lauderdale Hollywood International Airport, we're still working on a project. They have a second runway they built. That runway was built by the airport FAA. We worked with Broward County on acquiring the Hilton Hotel, which was on Griffin Road, and we needed to get that. The hotel was a 8-story hotel, 400 rental hotel units. We had to buy that. We wound up buying it, negotiating, without doing it eminent domain, although there was the threat of the eminent domain. That property was purchased for $63 million. That was a improved property commercial property. Our fees were $15,000.
Did you say 1.5?
$15,000. But we did it. It was pretty. There were other things involved in it. The relocation costs. We got money for relocation. That was a lot more than the acquisition, because we had to find another place for that hotel owner to get. We were going to try to get him in the airport, and that failed. So they actually, you know, were a company out of Louisville, Kentucky, and they just took the money and ran. But the relocation around it included there was a boat yard. We had to relocate them, and we had to relocate them, find them a place on water, and that took a while. So we made more money on that in terms of the company.
Luis, you had a question.
Yeah, I have two questions actually. When you work for affordable housing developers, do you help them on filling out the applications? Because I've seen those applications there. Some of them are really complicated.
Yes, we do. We'll help them in the application, because we fill in the certain parts that relate to how to do relocation, and it's a complicated element. With Landmark, the other nonprofit agency was Carrefour, and so they added the private sector. Public into it, and they were good. The applications, they did part of that application because they knew that.
Okay.
So we will, with the Jewish Federation project, we wrote the application, and we then, because we wrote it, we did the Davis-Bacon rate. Monitoring on that. So.
Okay. And my second question is, from the many low income tax housing applications, is there one that finances everything, the land acquisition and the building also?
It's a combination of money that's involved in it. Tax credits are given to assist the developer in making the dollar amounts to be able to deal with the construction.
And but it's required that they be near transportation.
Right. So with those, I mean, if you include the transportations and all the things that they require, they give you 100% of the project cost?
It's not 100%. It's never. It's only a portion of it.
Okay.
You get a tax credit for 20 years.
Right.
Do they bond it? Usually, is it a 20, a 30, a 10? Do they resell bond later?
No, they don't sell bonds on that. No.
I'm assuming if you get the TIF or whatever, or actually it would be a TIF, right? So if they would then place a bond, right?
Oh, a construction bond you're talking about? Or
no, against the increase in what the government would place a bond. And then I'm assuming that government bond sold off.
Yes.
That you could potentially buy back into.
Right. Yes. Yeah. They have no bonds.
What's the time period?
20 years.
20 years. That's the standard.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, explain Davis Bacon to them as well.
Oh, Davis Bacon is the requirements of building requirements. They have to maintain regulate. They have to be regulated. So it's Davis Bacon wage rates. You have to be able to. You have to.
To provide certified payroll for certain trades.
Right. So a laborer gets so much money, and we need to go and see that. We look at their certified payrolls to see that they're getting that money. If they don't, they get fined.
So is that inured to your benefit too, as well, or once again you just hit?
No, we get it's a fee for that.
Right. Okay.
I just asked that because it's sort of interesting.
$15,000 and up making $5 million.
Well, no, that's so right. The reason why I mentioned that is, you know, there are lots of different ways to earn in this business. You know, there's the commission side of the world and the brokerage side of the world. But I think what Howard has devised and his business model is there are lots of different fee-based structures. That's why, you know, we can go back to that commission, but the compensation slide. So what's interesting to me is that there are lots of different methods of compensation. And people say, well, I like to get a fee, I like to get a commission, I like to be compensated on a success basis. But I think that this business is one, just like with our firm, is that we earn fees in lots of different ways. And don't ignore that opportunity when you are out there in your own model of doing business. And I think that's important.
I think the last thing you want now is commission. With the 15% tax coming along,
well, we'll see if that comes. But I think that, you know, it's something to be alert to and aware of.
In terms of compensation, we're a private company, okay? So our fees are calculated. There's something called a FAR. That's a federal acquisition regulation, and in that it's a compliance of when we go to negotiate, we go in with a billable rate, and that billable rate has to include the wage rate of the let's say an acquisition agent, okay, or the billable rate for that acquisition agent plus the overhead for the company. That's a factor. And then a profit margin, which typically is 10% or 12%. So that FAR rate becomes the way we get paid in right-of-way. Here's what happens. If we're working 40 hours a week for a company, you can only work 40 hours, by the way, you can't work overtime, and there's no time and a half. In the government elements. So we will put five people in there with billable rates, and we have in FDOT, for instance, we have a contract where we put property managers inside District 6, and the property managers get this FAR rate, and it's just calculated the number of hours that people work. It's regulated. For instance, it's not 40 hours a week, 280 hours. We have to calculate out vacation, holidays, We have to calculate out people being sick. So our base hours for a full-time person is 1,920 hours, not 280 hours. So our business is based on making sure we have qualified staff who are billed and billed on the rates that we negotiate, so to speak. So again, it's we're an agency, we're a company that works on fees, not commissions. A point of information is that we always negotiate a rate. So the complexity of the project really determines what the rate is and the kind of person that goes into work. So if you're a senior acquisition agent, you make more money than an agent one or two. And that's calculated by FDOT.
So how many people are there in your firm?
22 now.
Maybe 23.
Huh? We'll talk about that because we have three people came out of this class. So we had three people who came out of this class, and they did a great job, and they went on to other things. Our company, we're a member of the Board of Realtors, the Miami Board of Realtors. Every one of our staff is a member of the board, and the Board of Realtors gives our agent, our company, a different fee because we don't list anything. We don't sell anything. And the other part about working with the Board of Realtors is that we are able to use the MLS. So when we have to go and relocate somebody, or when we have to find new properties, we've got a source of that information. One of the things, if you go back. What time do you want me to leave?
You want this one? 5 minutes? You can stay in, for 5 minutes or 5 hours.
Okay.
Which would you like?
Let me see. Go.
Just
go, go.
You stay for 5 hours.
The last hour is going to be alone.
Okay. Yeah, right there. Okay. This is a. This United Homes is a developer, and they have been buying mobile home parks. So,
Noah has Noah's one of your clients there.
What's that?
Noah Development.
Noah Development is in Belle Glade. We're actually working with NOAA Development on a new project in the Glades, which is kind of interesting.
I didn't know they were building anything in Belle Glade.
We're working in South Bay. There's where there's nothing being built.
That's close to that development you were talking about, right? Out there, 10 miles.
Right, but that's a different kettle of fish. That's just Arden out. Far west, and that's real development. Oh, excuse me, on Southern Boulevard. So we're talking about Belle Glade is a different world.
Yeah, so it is. It's the.
I love the ride. The ride over Okeechobee, all the way up there.
Oh, yeah. Okay. On State Road 27. Yeah, it's fun. United. So they bought a mobile home park, and the mobile home park had. I think 250 mobile homes. The residents are there's a Florida statute, 723, that protects people who live in mobile homes when the property owner wants to close that facility. And what United did was they were planning to build North Lauderdale, and they were going to build a two-story apartment complex. They did it actually, But we had to move, we had to get out, get the people out. So we were hired to, by the statute, we had to give the residents of a single wide mobile home park $1,220. A double wide gets $253. And or we can move the mobile home to another mobile home park that has a vacant lot. So we used the MLS to find mobile home parks that had vacant lots in it. And so that was kind of a reason why how we worked.
When you do that part of the relocation, like when you're helping a buyer property, are you getting commission for the person selling the property?
No commissions.
No, I
heard that.
But that was a different side. Now we're talking the other side. You're not dealing with the industry, you're dealing with, you know, Marielle, who has a listing of a home slot, so...
You have to be moved?
No, she's listing.
Oh.
So, no, I'm saying, so you don't get a commission.
How that works with the...
With anything, not specific, but, so, you know, you're moving somebody, you're helping them find a listing that's on the MLS, it's for sale, there's a co-broker percentage, so you're not entitled to that commission as well.
Now, when we're working on a mobile home park, we're going to get a fee for every negotiate a fee for each mobile home owner, and it may be around $500 or $600 to do all the work to get them out. Because we also, when we handle a mobile home park, we also manage the mobile home park. So now we've got our property management element into it. The owner says we want you to manage the mobile home, and as every time we take somebody out, we're reducing the income for the
yeah. But I think what he's saying is, let's say that you find.
I got it. Let me ask the question a different way.
He's layering the fees.
On 441, when you had to display somebody that had a house, when you did that, I'm sure they had to pick up one house. So you did the eminent domain, but you were required to relocate that person. So your agent goes in there, or whatever you call them, and through the MLS, they find a house, a comparable house, a comparable price. And that property is listed at, I don't know, say 5%. So it's 2.5 to a buying broker, 2.5 to a selling broker. When you put that person, you help negotiate the acquisition of that house, are you entitled to a commission from the seller of that particular property?
They're offering a commission.
No. Well, no, we don't. If we are relocating, what's your name?
Mike.
You're in a house on State Road 7, okay? You have to be moved. You own that house.
Right.
Okay. You will, you can find a house yourself, mm-hmm. or we'll help you find a comparable house. Mm-hmm. Okay. It's got to be decent, safe, and sanitary. If you have a two-bedroom or three-bedroom, we're going to get you a comparable house.
Right.
Okay, so let's say you have more kids than you should have in the house. We're gonna have to. They give you a four bedroom house. Okay, how that works is you will get the value of the house from the government agency, mm-hmm. and the replacement difference will also be there. So you will get we're gonna put you into a comparable house.
Let's say I work for you, and we have to relocate Marielle. So I help her find her house. We negotiate the acquisition. Since I work for you, is that commission coming into the urban?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. We're
getting a set fee, and you're getting a salary as a commissioner.
Right. No. So I just wonder. So Marielle's listed a house, then she's like, yes, double dip. Right.
She gets no double dip. You know. Actually, let me tell you why there's no double dip. Because the federal government audits us all the time. Not only federal government, the county, city will audit us.
So
the listing agent keeps the commission.
Yeah, so I was about to ask, I mean, you basically did all the work as a broker or as an agent for this person, and you're like, well, listing agent, there you go, I did it for you. You get, you're not by federal.
By the agreements we have, which come out of federal regulations, we're not doing it.
So, but what's interesting to me, and we don't have to, well, I think it's really interesting that Howard is showing us his business model. They earn a set fee for property management, for relocation, for finding a new home. And we don't have to know, but my sense is the Urban Group does just fine in the aggregate, and it's a different business model.
Right. The reason why I ask the question is because so you have the agreement with XYZ government agency to do all this work, and now you're going out and you're dealing with
the private sector,
you're dealing with these realtors, you know, and then you're getting, so that's why I was curious, because you're outside, you're dealing outside the scope of that.
If I went to you, Mike, as a realtor, mm-hmm. your real estate agent, salesman, salesperson.
Yeah,
okay, yeah.
Florida.
you show us the house, the homeowner likes it, it's mm-hmm. a comparable house. You as an agent, you will get
the commission.
You know, what you own, your broker gets half,
right?
You know, maybe more, right, or whatever. So you don't lose anything in terms of your ability to.
I was thinking there was a little extra revenue for the year.
I think Mark was saying our income comes because we have layer our activities, and all of that, those activities are, and we have, you know, this is a glimpse of all of our clients. We've been in business 31 years, and we have, it's an interesting element because we have our clients come back to us because they can't find other people. And this, we stay mostly in South Florida, but we work in other parts of the state. We worked in Louisville, Kentucky. I've mentioned Louisville before, but what did we do? And in Miami, we were the real estate asset manager for HUD. And that, what we did was, we sold HUD FHA homes through HUD. Anybody ever, you know about the real estate asset manager? We maintain the house, the property, and we facilitate with the other brokers to buy or sell the homes. So we had a contract in Miami. We had a contract in Palm Beach County. We had a contract in Tampa to do those things. So we made money because we competed, and we had a fixed unit fee for a house. We made money on the property management part, and then on the sale part. We did the same thing for the United States Marshal Service. The Marshal Service, the U.S. Marshal Service hired us to manage properties that were in forfeiture. You know what forfeiture is? Mm-hmm. You guys, you sold drugs, and you got caught.
You actually did the right person in the room.
Okay. So you sold drugs. Okay. And you know what you did? You had a gas station, and you let your
your tanks leak into the ground.
Environmental issue.
Anyway, you guys, you were put in jail.
Actually, a good example of what you of some a property the Marshal Service forfeited is Bernie Madoff's place. And so when he was thrown in jail, the Marshal Service basically took his penthouse in Manhattan because our company tried to do the sale of that. Unfortunately, we lost out in the bidding to that and to his Long Island estate as well. But those are the kinds of properties. Unfortunately, they're not always quite as luxurious.
I'm glad I didn't have any money to give to Bernie. But we were handling a guy. This is interesting. He was an insurance company in Chicago, and he guaranteed golf courses where you had a hole in one, and you could get $100,000, or you were a participant at the Heat game, and you got the ball from half court, or you know, and you won $100,000,
but they never paid.
Right, these guys did not pay, so they took his. This guy's house, he had a house on the Intercoastal in Fort Lauderdale, two-story house, beautiful, except we couldn't get into it because he locked it up, but we were managing it. So we were the manager of that facility. We sold those houses as an auction. It wasn't us. We hired, the firm we used is Fisher Auction.
Of course.
You know?
Yeah, I know, because we competed with Fisher to try to get the house. Never mind.
Yeah. Okay.
That's the mayor, right?
So this is what we're a public agency. You got to have a real estate license, and you got to compete to get the job. With Fisher, who did a better job than Mark, obviously.
That's okay. I spent $400 million in other cities. Let Fisher do their thing.
Yeah. So we were a partner with Fisher. They hired us, and
who happens to be the mayor of Pompano Beach, by the way. So,
okay. He still is.
He still is.
Yeah.
That's right.
So and we worked for them too. As a matter of fact, for the CRE. So
I already did the.
Their major study project, which they're going to present next week to Chris Brown.
Chris Brown from.
Head of CRA.
Yeah.
Is actually in Pompano Beach.
Yes.
For next week.
Yeah, they've got with Kim Brisbane
next week. Right.
Yeah.
It's a small world, folks. So just be careful.
Yeah.
Okay, go on.
So, with Fisher. We had a contract with Sarasota County to sell 2,200 escheated properties, and 2,200 of them. We sold them in an auction, and our job was to help them find with the properties. We did some of the environmental work, and this goes back to our company as a right-of-way agent and acquisition agent. One of our tasks is to clear the site. So a building is we buy the site, we relocated the residents. It's a 30 unit apartment building. We now have to do the demolition. So we supervise the demolition. Our agents are qualified as asbestos managers, and we are qualified to read the asbestos work. So here's an agent, a real estate agent, having to go it's a technical school to learn how to deal with the asbestos, because we're responsible for clearing the road. So if we're on state road 80 in Palm Beach County, there were 280 parcels. We
to complete our job, we have to certify that all of that land is cleared. And so what we hire environmental firms, and we hire demolition contractors. So one of our agents is a real estate agent. He also has a certification.
Don't you hire as well landscape consultants to help you relocate the trees that may be in the middle, or
no?
Those cases before.
If there's trees, the demo. They have to get a permit if there's trees
for the city.
Right. Yeah. In fact, we follow the local codes to do that. But with road widening, you have to remove the trees. You're not going to drive around. so that's an issue over government. But there's replacement.
There are some roads where the trees still remain, but that's far too.
No, look, it's in South Florida.
Here's the list of professional skills and.
Yeah, here's what you guys have to know. You gotta have a real estate license. Does everybody have a real estate license here?
Yeah, most of you do, and I think it's just something good that everybody should have.
You have to know the building codes and practices. I mean, I know that because I'm an urban planner. That's what got me into a lot of this stuff, because I did get a degree in urban planning. Yeah, knowledge of the real estate market, absolutely. Facility management and property management. I've been talking about this thing. This is not what a general real estate company does. You have to be able to work with diverse populations, and so our staff include people who speak English, Spanish, and Creole. No land use plan. That's another thing. It's good to know. And you should know real estate development and construction, and that's a helpful thing. This is really important. You've got to have a high level of accountability. I mentioned about auditing. We do get audited, and I'm happy to say we've never had a problem. We had one problem. We were working for Broward County Aviation, and on Griffin Road, and there was a mobile home park that we had acquired. But we had to also manage the mobile home park, and at the end of our audit, we were 52 cents, they couldn't find 52 cents in our
rounding error.
So I think it's a rounding error. Anything under a dollar,
it's
right?
A rounding error. In my book.
No. Well, it's they have their own finance company. Anyway, they cited us for that.
That falls in the material.
But they gave us the next job.
And that's good to know.
So those are the things you got to know. There's a compensation.
Right.
Let's
talk about this.
Okay. Internship. Good. We offer an internship two ways. We look for people to come to work for us and get involved in the work of FDOT. We had two people inside District 6, and you stay for a while, you learn it, and you can do whatever you want afterward. But at least you get knowledge of what working for a government agency is by a private company. The last two interns were hired by FDOT. So they took our intern away from us, but I can't take their people away. So if you're interested, I'm going to leave you some information about the company, and then you can give us a call. if you guys have anything to say, I don't want to stay too long, because I got to go.
No, I want to kick you out.
Okay.
And I'll put this, obviously, for the rest of you. So if you have any questions for Howard?
I saw your client list, you had the Carlisle route, and then the Atlantic Pacific. I kind of know. I know they got in a little, Carlisle group got in a little trouble. Did that blow back on you, any?
No.
Were you working with them at that point, or was that something?
Yeah, I was. We were working with Carlisle, and and then Atlantic Pacific came in, and they just kept our, they were renovating a 22-unit housing development, two-story, right near Jackson Memorial Hospital.
Yeah, when I met with them, they were saying that it was like a road partner, and then they created Atlantic Pacific, but it's still almost all the same people.
Atlantic Communities really is a good, they're a good client of ours, because we do their relocation work, they're a great company as far as I'm concerned. Nothing good, but good things to say.
All right, great.
Okay,
right,
thank you very much.
Thank you.
Please. What did I have? Here's a couple of, here's this program, okay? You guys can do whatever you want with it.
Thank you.
I'll
email them your contact.
I was thinking, my father was turning.
I'm just saying, because
I made a joke.
It'll be great. Oh, all right. Let me get out of here.
You would sleep in
the ammo. You were
He's the privilege that he's there every now and then.
Thanks.
Right, thank you. Appreciate it.
But that's the same deal, man.
It'll work for everything.
Perfect. Government benefits.
Oh, man.
Government work.
White. Good morning.
White.
Okay, have a good day. Thank you.
Thank you.
I sent you an email.
Yep.
And I'm going to give you the next 5 minutes to read that email, which is from the Upshot. Hopefully you all link into it. It's the link to the article that was in yesterday's New York Times, and that will lead into our discussion on structuring real estate deals.
Oh, the one you sent this now?
The one that I sent at 8 o'clock, or 8 10 this morning.
Oh, 5.
You're right, thank you, Ben. And I will post this too as well. You want the orange one, the black one, the yellow one.
What's the yellow one?
Yellow.
The yellow submarine.
Yeah, we all live.
No.
Take one.
Michael,
we get paid off of fees, not
commissions. Do you have
money?
I had said
it's
so many different ways.
It's the same answer.
I had that same question four times. I don't know. The worst was when I said, not specifically to trailer mobile homes. Something else. Again, he's still playing.
No, I didn't try to help you.
I know, but I had this question all lined up in my head, and I didn't want you to steal my thunder.
And it's still lined up.
Interesting.
That's a
Who
weird
put this
picture.
Together?
Whose arm bends like that?
Yeah, it's a backward hand.
It's very troubling.
Is
Is that the weird?
His photos in Photoshop, so
is that the weird arm shape?
Wrong hand.
Handshake?
The photo, yeah, that is weird. And then they
what's up with the handshake?
This is why I don't read the New York Times.
This is why I don't read the New York Times. Yeah, but what's up with the handshake, for real?
They flipped it. And then tried
he's
to.
He's got two right hands.
So it's the art of the bluff. I think it's a very interesting article, and it's important to hear when we talk about Beale's perspectives and that sort of thing. And Jason, you just sent me back another article. Is that correct?
I just read that.